Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I am Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is Keystone Pathogen Hypothesis. This is the last and the latest hypothesis to be studied. Again, it will be dealt under the following subheadings: Introduction, Core Concept, Applied Aspects and Drawbacks. So as we all know, George Haji Shingalis in the year 2012 gave Keystone Pathogen Hypothesis. This hypothesis focuses on keystone pathogens. Now, a keystone pathogen is something which is present in low levels or low abundance and is still able to cause the disease. This is the difference between keystone pathogen and an ordinary pathogen. An ordinary pathogen will be able to trigger inflammation or cause disease when present in abundance or higher levels. Whereas the same disease, the same inflammation can be caused by keystone pathogens when present in low levels or low abundance. So this is the difference. And the most common example of keystone pathogen in periodontal diseases is Porphyromonas gingivalis, the red complex bacterium. The entire hypothesis is studied upon the behavior and the disease activity of Porphyromonas gingivalis in animals. So one such study on mice showed P. gingivalis when present at very low levels, less than 0.01% of the total microbial load, was able to colonize the cavity and cause the disease as well. But in germ-free mice, although it succeeded in colonizing the cavities, but could not cause the disease. So this highlights the importance of commensal microbiota. That means Porphyromonas gingivalis alone cannot cause the disease. It requires the support of commensal microbiota to do the disease activity. So this is the first study and highlighted the importance of commensal microbiota. Clear till now? George Haji Shingalis in the year 2012 gave keystone pathogen hypothesis, which focuses on certain keystone pathogens. And these keystone pathogens are present in very low levels. One such example, Porphyromonas gingivalis present at less than 0.01% of the total microbial load. Now, these keystone pathogens will implement certain keystone mechanisms. There are three such mechanisms: TLR4 response manipulation, interleukin-8 subversion and corruption of complement system. We'll discuss one of them individually, one by one. So to begin with, TLR4 response manipulation. Now what is TLR? TLR is nothing but toll-like receptor and 4 is the number in the series. Number 4 TLR is... Okay. Now what TLR usually do? Upon receiving the stimulus or signal, they will release the cell mediators which will carry forward the phenomena of inflammation. But when P. gingivalis is present, it will interact with TLR4 via lipopolysaccharide, its virulence factor. Now there are actually two types of lipopolysaccharides, type 1 and type 2. Which lipopolysaccharide will be expressed depends on the levels of iron. Little flashback, if we go back to our previous video on ecologic plaque hypothesis, I had mentioned that increased GCF flow during inflammation will now provide certain nutrients favorable to certain pathogens to create the disease activity. Okay, and I had also mentioned at that time, this point is discussed in detail in keystone pathogen hypothesis. This is that point, so please pay attention. Lipopolysaccharide, the virulence factor, are of two types based on the lipid A structure, type 1, type 2. Type 1 is an agonist of TLR4, that means it will allow the TLR4 to perform its activity, whereas lipopolysaccharide type 2 is antagonist. Now, which one will be expressed depends on the levels of iron. During inflammation, iron will be more, and during health, iron will be less. So, during health, when iron is less available, lipopolysaccharide 1 is expressed, which is agonist, so TLR4 will be able to perform its activity. But during inflammation, increased availability of iron will allow lipopolysaccharide 2 to express, which is antagonist. So TLR4 activity is disturbed because lipopolysaccharide type 2 is antagonist. Now TLR4 response is disturbed by P. gingivalis via lipopolysaccharide 2. Now this means further inflammation is hampered, halted, and this allows survival of not just P. gingivalis but the entire commensal microbiota which it carries along to cause the disease. So this mechanism allows the P. gingivalis and other microorganisms to survive. Clear till now? TLR4 response manipulation. This is how P. gingivalis manipulated the TLR4 response. Coming to the next mechanism, that is interleukin-8 subversion. Interleukin-8 is a chemokine, a cytokine mainly involved in chemotaxis. Interleukin-8 subversion. Interleukin-8 is a chemokine, that is a cytokine mainly involved in chemotaxis. Interleukin-8 sends signals to neutrophils to arrive at the site of injury and form the wall of defense, that is wall, neutrophil wall. Okay. So now what P. gingivalis does? P. gingivalis blocks the synthesis of interleukin-8. How? By releasing serine phosphatase. P. gingivalis releases serine phosphatase, and serine phosphatase inhibits the synthesis of interleukin-8. So interleukin-8 synthesis is blocked. No interleukin-8, so neutrophils won't receive enough signals for chemotaxis to arrive at the site of injury. So neutrophils won't arrive at the site of injury. That means delayed wall formation or the wall formation is totally prevented. And this mechanism allows P. gingivalis and other microorganisms to grow and multiply. So this mechanism is important for their growth and multiplication. Again, this phenomena is called local chemokine paralysis. We'll understand this terminology as well. Local because P. gingivalis interacts with interleukin-8 locally. Chemokine because interleukin-8 is a chemokine, a cytokine mainly involved in chemotaxis. And paralysis because the inhibition or the blockage of interleukin-8 synthesis will hamper the chemotactic activity heavily. So, in a sense, the chemotaxis phenomena is paralyzed. That is why the term local chemokine paralysis. Please remember this terminology. It is important in Viva-Vos point of view and as a short answer in theory exams. So, this is about interleukin-8 subversion. Coming to the last, main and the most commonly implemented or utilized mechanism. I will tell you why. Why I am saying it is the most commonly implemented or utilized mechanism. Corruption of complement system. Now complement system, as we all know, is a part of innate immunity. For any pathogen to survive, it has to avoid or bypass this complement mediated identification and killing. Now what P. gingivalis does? P. gingivalis releases gingivanes. Okay. Now with the help of gingivanes, now what gingivanes does, it will interact with complement factor 3 and complement factor 5. First, it will cleave them into its active fragments C3b and C5a. C3b is a phagocytic enhancer. Please remember, phagocytic enhancer. And C5a is a cell activator. Now what gingivanes do? First, they cleave the complement factors into its active fragments and then degrades them. Okay. This entire phenomena, when studied in an in vitro study, showed that it takes up to 1 hour. It takes up to 1 hour for gingivanes to cleave them into its active fragments and then degrade these active fragments. But C5A to interact with its cell receptor C5AR on neutrophils will take only just few seconds. So, assumingly, before undergoing degradation by gingivane, C5A will send the signals to C5A receptor on the neutrophils, which will then enter into crosstalks with TLR2. This is another toll-like receptor, TLR2. Enters into crosstalks with TLR2. This TLR2, poor fellow, is already activated by P. gingivalis. Okay. So, multiple crosstalks with TLR2 by P. gingivalis and now by C5A receptor. So TLR2 will release lots of mediators and too much of inflammation. Too much. Okay. And this is not good. Too much of anything is anyways not good. Too much of inflammation. But if you go back to C3b, which is a phagocytic enhancer, it has got degraded. Nothing to do with C3b. It did not do its activity. So, in spite of too much of inflammation, the phagocytic enhancer is absent. So, the phagocytic capacity of neutrophil is impaired. So, what is the point of too much of inflammation when the end point is not achieved? The ultimate end point of inflammation is killing the microorganism, phagocytosis. And due to the degradation of this C3b by gingivitis, the phagocytic capacity of neutrophil is impaired. So this inflammation led to nothing but just damage, destruction of tissues and the collateral damage. So this is why P. gingivalis, P. gingivalis causes the periodontal disease, actually accelerated disease and rapid bone loss because of this particular phenomena, the crosstalks. Now, I told this is the most commonly used mechanism. How do I know that? Again, it is an animal study, mice study again. Studies in mice which lacked C5a receptor or TLR2, when P. gingivalis was introduced into such mice which lacked C5a receptor or TLR2, P. gingivalis was not able to cause disease. So this means this is the mechanism mostly utilized by P. gingivalis to cause the periodontal disease. And this is what is the core concept of keystone pathogen hypothesis, the studies and the three main mechanisms implemented by P. gingivalis. Okay, this completes the core concept, TLR4 response manipulation, interleukin 8 subversion also called as local chemokine paralysis and corruption of complement system. Okay, coming to the drawbacks, before I discuss the applied aspects, I have a reason for that. Drawbacks, although this hypothesis tried to discuss the genetic factors, which was not discussed in ecologic plaque hypothesis, it did try to touch upon the genetic aspects, that is by the mice study which lacked C5a receptor R or TLR2, but ultimately everything is based upon animal studies and not human studies. So to implement the data based on animal studies onto humans is actually not practical. So this is the major drawback of keystone pathogen hypothesis. This entire hypothesis is based on animal studies and not humans. Something that has to be implemented on humans, that has to be studied upon humans. So the animal study based data cannot be utilized. So suggestion here would be to study the same behavior, same patterns, the same disease activity of P. gingivalis on humans and then translate them into the applied aspect. And that is why I discussed drawbacks before I come to applied aspect. There is hardly anything to tell about in applied aspect because practically nothing is much available based on this hypothesis per se. But there are many suggestions, that is targeted therapies, targeted diagnostic aids, the biomarkers based upon the mechanisms utilized by P. gingivalis, but nothing based on animal studies possible. First thing to get some applied aspects based on this hypothesis is to study the same behavior, same pattern, same disease activity of P. gingivalis or any other keystone pathogen for that matter on humans first. The data from humans will give you the accurate data about the host response. And then those findings can be translated into applied aspects in form of diagnosis and treatment or therapeutic interventions. So this is all about keystone pathogen hypothesis, owing to the major drawback that it is entirely based on animal studies. There is hardly anything to discuss about in applied aspects, but there are many more suggestions and it's a vast zone available for exploring and research. So can be carried forwarded and can be translated into applied aspects on humans first. So this completes the hypothesis, keystone pathogen hypothesis. Just a brief summary, George Hadjiseghalis in the year 2012 gave keystone pathogen hypothesis. Keystone means some levels, low levels and low abundance microorganisms, and the most important keystone pathogen and studied extensively is P. gingivalis. The three main mechanisms, TLR4 response manipulation, interleukin 8 subversion and corruption of complement system. So this completes the hypothesis, keystone pathogen hypothesis. And if you still have any doubts or any queries, please ask me in the comment section below or mail them at dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day.